So my task is to describe to you a bit the progress on the field of metabolomics, always in the context of a background genome. And part of it will be actually on the subject of pharmacogenetics, metabolomics, and I will push a definition that has been circulated. Let's see this one. Okay. So on definitions, we are all familiar what's the metabolomics, that means the survey of metabolites, usually 1,000 to 5,000, depending on platforms and dictionaries. Genomics, of course, pharmacogenetics, very familiar to you. And the proposition of pharmacometabolomics that basically integrates metabolomics with pharmacogenetics into some sort of a novel approach to individualized drug therapy. Most of it has been referred to the prediction of that drug response, but you will see there's also the possibility to define pharmacometabolomics as the description also of the consequences of use of a drug, and I think that will be a particularly attractive application. So I think to give a bit of the background, I divided the talk in three levels. One is to understand how much diversity there is across humans in metabolomic profiles. And I think we are all pretty much thinking that the metabolome is always very much modified by the environment. And I think it's important to be able to measure precisely that question. How much of the metabolome is genetic? How much of it is exogenous? I will discuss the metabolome as the generation of what I will describe as rich biomarkers. I think it's a very important concept to discuss. And finally, I will actually end with an example of pharmacometabolomics. I will illustrate each of these sections with actually work that we have published recently. So the first question is metabolomics as an exogenous or endogenous trait. And of course, there is a bit of everything. But our first surprise when we approach this from the standpoint of officially measuring heritability of the metabolome is that very large sections of the human metabolome is actually pretty heritable, including some components that are not only heritable, but absolutely stable over decades for the same person. So they are a trait. Yes, there is microbial metabolites. Yes, there is exogenous metabolites. But there are many metabolites that are pretty much defined by your genetic. How much? We published last year about a large study where we already saw 101 loci affecting 246 metabolites that were basically more than one-third of what we were measuring. So meaning that not only we can say that they are heritable, but actually we can map them to the genome, which is the ultimate proof that there are genetic implications behind our metabolic profile. The advantage of using genetic associations today is that we can move to the whole genome, and that allows us something very important, is that we can see what we saw before, that means genetic association analysis using arrays, using genotyping, where we can see many loci with small effects. But now with whole genomes, we can see in orange, we can start seeing basically, if we can see, yeah, you can see that we can identify rare variants in the population with very important effects. And this is more or less what we would define as the architecture of genetics of metabolomics. That means, yes, many people with a few variants that are common and produce small effects in blue, all the way to some people with important like truncations of a protein that give rise to these large effects. Now, what I write to the left is, I think, an important thing to think about and meditate, is that just getting a population of healthy people, healthy adults, we can find 10% of people carrying rare variants. So that means metabolomics is actually one more example of a description of the human being as extremely common frequency of rare variants. And I know this is a kind of an oxymoron. That means there is a lot of rare variation for metabolomics, and as I will say at the end, somehow metabolomics is like pharmacogenomics, that in the cytochromes we have lots of people with unusual things producing very abnormal levels of metabolites, and we don't know what that medically means. Let me put an example. So if we look at one particular pathway, this will be this fatty acid metabolism and beta oxidation, and you see the pathway there to the right, and you can see that almost at every pathway we can find somebody. These are all individual people with individual variants affecting somewhere on that pathway, and you can see how they kick up towards very, very high elevation levels of particular metabolites, as there is a bottleneck to processing the metabolites, very much like pharmacogenetics. Many people, very rare effects, and extreme effects on the pathways. So the summary of this part, again, is that no matter how important it is, and it is important, microbiome, exogenous metabolites, the metabolome profile is a trait of an individual, and it's a pretty constant trait over decades. There is lots of common variation, there's a lot of rare variation in the community, and for the most part, we don't know the medical counterpart. There are many rare variants with significant effects on unique metabolites. And again, there's no knowledge on the consequences for health. Now, as an anecdote, many of the things we see in healthy adults, or within their healthy adults, are metabolites that if the person was a child and was homozygous, they will be classified as inborn error of the metabolism. That means that the carriers of variants, heterozygous people, don't have just a carrier status with normal metabolites. They have 1, 2, 3 standard deviation elevation of metabolites that are the metabolites of inborn error of the metabolism if that person had been homozygous. So once that we have this basic concept that there is a important component of genetic influences, there is also tons of diversity, we start thinking about applications and how to use this combination of genome and metabolome as biomarker aspects. And I will put one example that we just published last week, is when you get a common disorder like obesity. Now, in obesity, we applied these two approaches, genome and metabolome, and we could very quickly, by analyzing in an unsupervised manner, we could classify the people in all possible formats. The four extant groups will be the four depicted here. That means we have, with all the ranges, of course, we have normal weight people with what we call an obese metabolome, and we'll go over that. We have obese people with an obese metabolome, people with a healthy metabolome despite an obese phenotype, and the healthy people in both matters. Now, why is this type of approach relevant, particularly in terms of understanding a disorder that is heterogeneous and discussing metabolites? So if you look at this approach and concentrate first on this particular panel, we have the three normal weights. That means normal people overweight and morbidly overweight, more than 30 BMI. And we have these people that have the same weight, but we have classified them as opposite metabolomes. That means they have the metabolite of an obese person but normal weight, or they have the metabolite of a healthy person and obese or overweight personality. So keep an eye on those two colors, light blue and pink. So if you go through the things that we classify as metabolic syndrome, so insulin resistance, diastolic blood pressure, waist hip ratio, total cholesterol, androgenicoid, percental fat, etc., you see that despite equal weight, those two groups always separate. That means the light blue align with healthy people, the pink align with obese people. And these people had the same BMI. So what this is telling you is that what matters is how much obesity has deranged your metabolite, your metabolome, not how you look from outside. And this is not a new concept. I think we have discussed about this, particularly in the field of obesity endocrinology, for years now. Now, what is different here is that we are actually looking at something that is extremely volatile, is the metabolite profile, and it's telling you with a certain urgency that obesity is not the accumulation of fat over decades and then eventually you may get a problem. It is an active disorder of the metabolome. How does this match with the things that we're used to see? So for example, here again, I take people with the same BMI, opposite metabolome. Same BMI, opposite metabolome. Same BMI for these two people, same BMI for these two people. These are classified as normal weight, classified as severely obese. Look at the intra-abdominal content of fat, the fat that we know are metabolically active and predictive of disease. You can see that these two people of equal weight have a profound metabolome disturbance and liver fat, abdominal fat. You have this person that has the same weight as this one. This one has a massive amount of intra-abdominal fat, and this one actually looks more like this person here. Now, all this is, of course, attractive as a hypothesis, but the important thing is what are the consequences of not so much the obesity, but the metabolic obesity that we are profiling. And I think the most convincing thing will be here. So these are 2,000 people followed for an average of 13 years. We had the baseline metabolite metabolome. We have a intermediate metabolome. We had the up to 13 years metabolome. And we can see that already at baseline where these people were recruited, like around 30 years old, 40 years old, those famous groups, remember, always aligned. That means those are people, whether obese or not obese, but with a metabolic disturbance, are the ones who get angina, they are the ones that get a stroke or cardiovascular disorders, they are the ones that get hypertension. So what matters is not the weight, it's the amount of disease that is hidden behind the weight disturbance. And that's at baseline. So these people start already sick. Look at the follow-up over the next ensuing decades. And you can see that, and I think this is a kind of a surprise, but anyway, the blue people were the overweight or obese with a healthy metabolome. They have no event. I think this was just by luck and chance. They must have something eventually. But see how they separate. So these are the two groups that have a healthy metabolome, the healthy people and the slightly overweight or obese with a healthy metabolome. So what separates both at baseline and during follow-up is the metabolite profile, the amount of disease that is associated with your fat deposition and not so much the fat. I want to close this particular section with something that for me is an important issue for discussion here. As I was introduced as a practicing physician for a number of years, I know that we love reductionistic and easy solutions. Okay? So if you have for something a level of 100, you are at the border. If you have 101, you are abnormal. If you have 99, you are normal. And that's not the way it works. So let's discuss this rich biomarker profiling. When we associate with BMI, that means with the global obesity parameter, a number of things that we can measure. Glucose. Yeah, glucose associates with high BMI at this level of around 7%. Take it as a value of variance or whatever. Mannose, also famously associated with obesity, as a single marker, the same thing. Urate, which is actually the best single marker of obesity at metabolic level, it alone explains 15%. This is a full model of age, sex, and what you measure in your routine laboratories, cholesterol and triglycerides and glucose. So we model everything that we're using in the clinics today, plus the important factor H, sex, what we get is an explanation of 30% of the weight. This is a signature of the best metabolites that I showed before, and this is if I just throw the whole metabolome into the analysis. And this is what I call the Siri and the Google Translate metaphor, is that we should not shy from complex models because all we do is gain accuracy with the new computing and new approaches. That means if we were to redefine how to use laboratories in medicine, probably we should think about how to build rich biomarkers that are complex, that are using massive amount of data, because everybody knows that the why Siri became better and why Google Translate became better was not because they made it simpler, it's because they made it more complex, more rich, and for every single thing that you add, you gain accuracy. So again, if I am going to explain BMI, this is what I get with single markers, classic laboratory markers, and just a metabolome alone. Now, not to depress you, the polygenic risk score of BMI, it's known, so there's nothing new here, to predict very little. It's correct. People who are very obese tend to have higher polygenic risk score. But in this case, intermediate phenotypes, metabolome, probably transcriptome, proteome, are a better measurement than the genetics, with exception, of course, of Mendelian disorders like MC4R that are very clear markers of obesity. So if we summarize this, is look at metabolome analysis as a source of a new generation of rich biomarkers to be used as a rich biomarker tool. It's extremely agile. So if you lose some weight, your metabolome normalizes rapidly. So it's actually, it could probably be interesting to see how it would work on clinical trials because you can actually see the dose response almost immediate. And again, it summarizes in one single analysis multiple tests that are part of the medical routine. Discussing this paper with the reviewers and the editors, they say, well, why do you need these particular tests when you can do a DEXA scan and normal laboratories and normal tools? So the reviewers were discussing with us putting multiple tests one after another to arrive to the same place. So we have still this attachment to classic medicine and this difficulty to assume that some of these tools may summarize information in a more comprehensive way, avoiding that you have to do 10 or 15 independent individual tests to arrive to the same conclusion on the health of a person. So let's complete the last model that is closer to the goal of this meeting, is the problem of pharmacometabolomics or the promise of pharmacometabolomics. And again, I will use a work that we published last year, or this year actually, that is how a drug perturbs the metabolome and how this could eventually help both understand the mechanism of action, toxicity, and particularly unexpected effects of a drug. Again, think that this is a many markers, therefore you have the chance to test things that were not tested in the past. In this case, we get several hundreds of people, and we just, in an unsupervised way, we classify those people that receive Tylenol, acetaminophen, and those that don't. How do we know that? Because we see them, we see it. So we see 9 of the metabolites of acetaminophen, so there is no doubt of who's taking acetaminophen and who's not. Which, by the way, I think is a very interesting property of metabolomics. You don't need to ask anymore what people are taking. You just have to look for it. In particular, look for the metabolites to know that it is the signature of a particular use of a particular drug. So we know in an unequivocal way that these people are taking acetaminophen and these people are not taking acetaminophen. The surprise came when we start seeing, and here I just put the example of 8 hormones. And each time you see blue, is on the group of people taking acetaminophen. Each time you see red, is on the people that we know for certain they are not taking acetaminophen. And you see that each time there's acetaminophen, there is less of the particular hormone that is shown here. What's this? These are the sulfated hormones. Now, I'm sure many of you know that acetaminophen interferes sulfation, and we'll go into that in a moment. Now, acetaminophen has been in the market for 50 years. Has a very well-known toxicity. That was the one we were actually looking for. We thought we were going to see slight disturbances of liver metabolism. That's not what we saw. What we saw was, after 50 years of use of this drug, an interesting and unusual pattern. When we look at that in just a bit more detail here, is to make sure that we balance this with whatever other particular issues we could measure in these people. So this is a males, females. We already knew that females, particularly around the age of 50, they start decreasing the amount of sulfated hormones together with other hormonal profiles. So we can read the effect of sex. We can read the effect of age. So it keeps going down, the sulfation. And then there's the big jump, that's acetaminophen. And then that's the a more complex model. And you will see why we're bringing up SULT2A1. And then finally, this will be the moment of horror, but there's very few people. If you are a female, more than 50 years old, taking acetaminophen, and with particular set of variants in SULT2A1, then theoretically you will arrive at around 2 standard deviations, less sulfated hormones. Now, does this matter? Like I said before, with many of the metabolomic signatures we see in adults, we have no clue. And this is one, I think, one of the beauties of deploying a new technique, is that we're seeing something that we have no idea of what the consequences may be. There has been now for 3-4 years a lot of literature on people working with mice and working with population analysis concerned about the possibility of acetaminophen as the prime pain medication during pregnancy, that they could distort masculinization of the fetus. And this is, I have no idea whether that literature is very solid or not. I know that this is a rambling. There's a lot of publications in a particular field talking about the concerns about this hormonal disturbance by pain medication. On the other side, there's an interesting animal model about manipulating sulfated hormones in the brain as intermediates in pain and sensation. So just by the back door, we are kind of confronted with the paradox and say, well, we see this anomaly in sulfation. Epidemiologists are concerned about masculinization of fetuses. Neuroendocrinologists are interested in sulfated hormones as pain molecules. So it opens the door to something that also was unknown, is how does Tylenol work? And nobody knows. Again, I made no claim here of anything. I have no idea. I'm saying just confronting this evidence of a reduced sulfation of hormones makes me again think whether this links either to mechanisms of action or to some of the animal models of paracetamol or Tylenol in pregnancy in mice. And then the last thing here, to join again genetics and metabolomics, I think they always can be assigned together. There's a technique that we like very much called Mendelian randomization, that is a way to phenocopy whatever you see at the genomic level. So if you see an anomaly, Tylenol does X, then I say, is there a mutation that does the same thing as Tylenol? Why? Because I find the mutation, I find the mechanism. Again, I repeat, because each month I forget the concept. It's a point of phenocopying. You put a drug, you see an effect, and then on genetics pure, you look at people with any variant that actually could phenotype that process. If you match those, and there's lots of examples you can do it, you will say, okay, that's where it happens. So we did that completely blindly, and here's where we fell. That means that the mutations that phenocopy Tylenol is, again, SULT2A1. The reviewer, as always, I mean, we have very entertaining discussion with reviewers lately, says, we already knew that. says, yeah, what's my fault? It's not my fault that Tylenol actually acts on SULT1 and is the pathway of sulfation of hormones. So Tylenol occupies SULT1, and for the few days that Tylenol is there, there's a crunch, and there's no sulfation of the hormones. Now, why is it attractive? Because here is the other one, SULT2B1. We have SULT2B1 truncations and missense variants. We don't see it phenocopying Tylenol. So I can tell the reviewer, you were right on one domain. SULT1, yes, it's associated with Tylenol. But you also told me that SULT2B1, and there is no association with Tylenol. I suspect, I could still be wrong, that the real one that gets hit by Tylenol is SULT1, not SULT1, because that's what genetics tells me. That's what Mendelian randomization. So again, think in your mind of other drugs, other toxicities, expected and unexpected, and the possibility that you can phenocopy and do Mendelian randomization to see what is the place where a drug, in an unsuspected way, may be colliding with a natural process. So the summary of this part is that, again, the metabolomics is a very sensitive measurement of known and unknown effects of drug. And I would love to see that every single new drug and all the top 100 drugs in the US market were profiled by metabolomics, so we could see exactly where there's surprising things. As you saw, we can understand the mechanism of action and toxicity of some medications, and in combination with genetics, we can map the set of interaction if it happens to be the case that there is a human variants that do an effect. And as I showed in the first part of the talk, there is so much metabolomics human diversity that you have a really top chance of finding something phenocopying any drug, because there is so many rare variants doing so many strange things. So let's conclude here. Metabolomics, even though we talk about genomics, we talk about everything, it's true that metabolomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, etc., have not done yet too much for precision medicine. Why is it interesting? And again, I summarize some of the big points. It is a trait of the individual for a large percentage of human metabolites. It's at the same time, which is interesting, sensitive to perturbation and to disease, as I showed with the obesity example. As you can see, we can do metabolome to imaging. I could have done an association study between MRI or DEXA and the metabolome. It would have worked. I could have done it with diabetes, not BMI. I could have done it with any parameter and BMI and a metabolome equally. And again, I think it shows that we need to think about the concept of rich biomarkers and accept that we will eventually have black boxes that see the whole data and classify it better than we would classify with single markers. And as I mentioned earlier, think about metabolomics as the new pharmacogenetics. There is everything that you want to find, you will probably find it. Truncations, loss of function, and lots of presence of diversity in any given human population. I want to thank the people for the work I presented today. We used to work together. We are all now in different institutions. Tao Long, Lee Ciruli, Isaac Cohen, Tim Spector for the fantastic twin UK with the follow-up of 2 decades. And Human Longevity Metabolome, the companies where either I worked for in the past or I collaborated with and supported many of these analyses with very solid resources. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mary, for that very provocative discussion. We have plenty of time for questions. Yes?
Thank you for a very nice talk. My name is Gert-Jan van Ommen from Leiden University. I am actually slightly puzzled by the very low yield of the genomic risk score. And I wonder if this might be because these genomic risk scores are very early in the day still, and many of them have been derived from GWAS studies that were rather underpowered and over-publicized. And I wonder if, and actually there are many, because you can create and calculate them in many different ways. Would you have some sort of a generic explanation why the genomic risk score scores so lower than actually some of the metabolite scores that you have in it? Or might this be actually an effect of what actual genomic risk scores you use for giving this example?
Yep. So the 2.5 variants explained that I show here are consistent with literature. So it's surprising because these are several hundred of common variants contributing using the same tool that everybody uses. So we are right on what people have found for BMI. Now, this could be a uniqueness of BMI for common variants because other risk scores can go to 20%, 30%, even for macular degeneration, you can reach 50% of variants explained. So it is shared by many groups that we don't get a lot of common genetic variants explaining large amounts. The story changes for rare variants. I did not want to show it here. So when we get morbidly obese individuals, we can find in 6-7% we can find MC4R, and it's just one of the main genes. There are another four that in the same pathway that contribute to rare variations with extreme phenotypes. And we actually began exploring the contrary, lipodystrophy rarities, and we see also the signature. So as we progress in rare variants, we'll be covering some points percent of the population. The same thing at metabolome, we'll end with X percent, 3%, 5% of the population that may actually carry a rare variant and explaining the morbid process. So yes, as we get both common and rare variant, I think you will see a shift in the genetic contribution being attributed.
Yeah, I think that explains it all. The rare variants is where the power lies of the genetic risk scores.
And that has there's been not so many studies yet.
Thank you so much for the presentation. It's really interesting results. So my question is about will the environmental factors affect the metabolome profile, which will not be heritable most probably? And if that is the case, how is it possible to differentiate the metabolic signature related to diseases in such conditions?
So there are two answers. One is there is a work by Tim Spector with us, there's work by other groups where you can basically do the microbiome part of the metabolome, and you can also arrive to signatures of obesity. The untargeted approaches of metabolome, it doesn't care. So you can generate a signature that would include both endogenous metabolites modifications as well as external. Of all the top markers of obesity that we identified, only one was microbial, even though we also have the chance of capture other microbial or environmental. I think as the metabolomic dictionaries, the libraries where they can attach names to products, which is one of the limitations, grows, you may get more and more numbers of exogenous metabolites that are maybe not scored today, and you will get a contribution of exogenous. So I think as take it as the earlier aspect of classifying people by metabolome. And yes, the top players were endogenous, maybe because we know more about those and they are better represented in the platforms.
All right, thank you.
Hey, I was curious about the acetaminophen results and whether or not you looked for correlations with paracresol or other substrates of the sulfur.
With picresol?
Yeah.
What we saw, what's the name? Is it a peak result that is an environmental that actually has the same molecular structure?
It's a microbial metabolite.
A microbial. Peak result was not on the top. I could search where it was in the list, how low down, yeah. But it was not on the top marker.
Hi, Mohammed Khalid Al-Wasiya from the Ministry of Health of Saudi Arabia. Do you think the role of the epigenetic in the abnormal metabolome would exceed the role of genetics?
Once that you depart the genome, everything is dynamic. So whether epigenetic or transcriptome or protein phosphorylation. There is no issue that this cannot be modeled, but it has to be measured. You will probably have to, like it was done here with metabolome, you will probably have to have several time points, classify the person as for their epigenetic signature, and then process it. Today, there is some platforms for epigenetic characterization. There is still early. I think, for example, the Illumina 400K or whatever epigenetic chip is an approach. It works for some things well, like aging, but I think it's difficult to consider those as true high-throughput, profound classifiers today.
Actually, what I thought, since it's a metabolome, it has more to do with the environment than the remaining transcriptome. So.
Well, yeah, depends how you take the epigenome as being also important reflectant of environment. I think the prior question was excellent in that, is that maybe we should not care what part is external and what part is internal, as long as the signatures and the processes are recorded in a way that is useful for disease classification. So maybe that separation of exogenous and endogenous is not so interesting in practical terms of disease biomarking.
Thank you.
Yeah, welcome.
Okay, thank you again, Dr.